at the bar, mustn't go and wake the rest of the residents up at midnight, and so a dog mustn't be allowed to bark. And
I know, but you can't talk a dog out of barking in the way that you can. You can explain somewhere that they're not allowed to smoke.
But you see, if we come to Dr. Mugford's Animal Behaviour Centre, we'll teach them how to be well behaved and as nice as PC. And really, there shouldn't be a problem. Most dogs are very well managed, well used to being in hotel rooms. And of course, if you crate train puppies, get them used to being in an enclosed device, then you can leave them in the hotel room while you go downstairs to dinner and so on. So, people like to travel with their pets. Pets do have to go from A to B. We're in an increasingly mobile society all round, and they're part of the family.
Well, Dr. Mugford, thank you very much. If they're all as good as PC, I'm sure we'll be fine.
Yes, lovely, lovely dog. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let's return, though, now to our main story this morning, the accident involving the BBC Top Gear presenter Richard Hammond, seriously injured in a car crash, of course, while driving that jet-powered car while filming for the programme at an airfield near York. Let's speak to the fastest man in the world now, Wing Commander Andy Green. He drove at 350 miles an hour in the JCB Diesel Max in America this summer to break that diesel land speed record. Joining us now from our central London studio. Thank you for speaking to us this morning. Richard Hammond travelling at an extremely high speed, 300 miles an hour, we think. What sort of physical and mental pressures and stresses does that put on any driver?
Clearly, it's going to be hard work for anybody. Now, Richard, of course, has a tremendous background in driving a variety of cars, working under pressure of television, the pressure of deadlines, racing. It's not going to be easy for anybody to do, but he should be well qualified to do that. And, of course, terrible to hear about that accident. And if I could just say, everybody's thoughts right now are with Richard and his family, and of course the whole of the rest of the crew.
Yeah, and everyone of course shares that. But I think it, just in terms of the preparedness for driving any vehicle over 150, 160 miles an hour, just explain the sort of the stresses that occur to any driver in that sort of situation.
Well, of course, I've got the enormous advantage being a fighter pilot in the Royal Air Force. I've spent 20 years being trained by the best in the world. So physically and mentally, that all makes perfect sense. That's very much part of my day job. It is perhaps more creditable that somebody like Richard can step into that and actually give it a go at short notice. Unfortunately, there is always a risk with anything, whether it be crossing the road, climbing a tree, riding a bike, walking to the South Pole, or indeed trying to set a land
speed record.
But
that's precisely my point, and the debate is being raised now about a TV presenter doing something like this. Perhaps, do you think that TV presenters' programmes are pushing non-experts, people who are not equipped like you are as a fighter pilot, to do something like this?
Well, that's, in this case, it would be completely unfair to speculate. I don't know. I know Richard just a little bit. I know he has a background in a lot of racing and a lot of different talents. He's a very adaptable, very capable young man. I don't know the preparation he went through for this particular record. I don't know of the preparations that his team put in, so it's completely unfair to speculate. But the fact is that with any record like this, the aim is to minimise the risk wherever possible. But you cannot do anything in life at minimum risk. And some risks are worth taking. Life is a more interesting place because people fly around the world or walk to the South Pole or go to the top of Everest, or indeed set land speed records. It makes life interesting and colourful, and it would be a grey and dull world without it. So there is always a small chance, anytime you get into any kind of vehicle, that something will happen. You try and control those. It's a terrible shame for Richard and his family that didn't happen on this particular occasion.
And I suppose the other problem is that mechanical failure at speeds like this really ultimately always end in something pretty catastrophic.
Well, of course, whenever you're designing a record project, safety is uppermost, and you design for what happens if we have mechanical failure, structural failure, tyre failure, engine failure, brake failure, parachute failure. The list goes on and on, minimising the implications of all of them. We don't know what happened in this particular case. The fact that Richard is now making a recovery is great news, and clearly the guys will look at it. Record breaking, any kind of motor racing, has its attendant risks. But it's an exciting and fun thing to do and to watch. And as I say, some risks, I believe, are worth taking.
And we all wish Richard Hammond well, of course. Wing Commander Andy Green, thanks very much indeed for speaking to us.
Let's just take a quick look at the scene at the Kennedy Space Centre, where they're expecting the arrival, the touchdown of Atlantis, the space shuttle, in the next 25 minutes or so. Of course, they delayed the touchdown by 24 hours because of an unidentified floating object alongside the shuttle, but they're confident today. So coming down in 25 minutes, we'll have it live here on News 24.
All that to come. Before that, let's catch up with some weather news now. Jay's got all the details. Jay.
Thanks, Tim. It's mixed fortunes, really, across the UK today. Some of us enjoying some really fine weather. It's really warm and quite windy for the majority. The wind's coming up from the south, and that's bringing some very warm air with it. And also, we've got a good deal of sunshine to go with that. And we will see some unusually high temperatures for this time of the year. Now, you can see where the sunshine is across most of England and Wales. A notable southerly breeze and plenty of sunshine. Temperatures in London, 25 degrees and rising through the early afternoon, and even 24s and rising up towards Manchester and Newcastle. The warm weather crosses the borders into southern and eastern parts of Scotland. Still a little bit of rain to be clearing away from Glasgow. Quite windy with that rain, and after some wet, windy weather across Northern Ireland, the rain this afternoon slowly eases away towards the north and the west. Pretty windy too across Wales, but here we're back into the sunshine through the afternoon. Certainly a pleasantly warm afternoon, 23 or so degrees in Cardiff, and down across the southwest again. It's a beautiful afternoon, plenty of sunshine, but a notable, really quite strong southerly breeze. Now, through the afternoon, not a great deal changes, really. Most of England and Wales fine, sunny and warm, and that warmer weather eventually spreads its way to the central lowlands of Scotland. So Glasgow brightening up through the afternoon, and maybe things drying up a touch in Belfast. 18 to 22 degrees, not too bad at all. 26, 27, even 28 degrees is possible somewhere in eastern England. Now, this evening, things will change for the windier down across the southwest. We'll see some very strong winds developing. In fact, we could well see severe gales pushing their way up from Cornwall through the Irish Sea. Gust of wind to 70, possibly even 80 miles an hour. But in spite of the wind, it's not a cold night. We'll see temperatures 15, 16, possibly even 17 degrees in one or two spots. Through the morning, the winds will slowly ease down, and we'll also see some wetter weather across eastern England. Some light and some patchy rain here, but fairly cloudy skies. Further west, something a little bit brighter, particularly in the north, but down towards the southwest, we'll see quite a few showers getting going here, and showers too across Northern Ireland. Notably, those temperatures still not too bad, but several degrees down on today's values. Into the weekend, it looks like a mixture of sunshine and showers for those southern and western areas, and rather grey once again up and down that eastern coast. Maybe some sunshine in the west of Scotland, but for the Ryder Cup in Dublin, it looks like a mixture of sunshine and some blustery showers right the way through the weekend. Bye for now.
A man is arrested in connection with the deaths of three sailors who drowned when their yacht disappeared in the English Channel. The other headlines on BBC News 24 at 11. The Top Gear presenter Richard Hammond is seriously ill in hospital after crashing at high speed in a jet-powered car. The Attorney General says phone-tapping evidence could be allowed in court to convict the most dangerous criminals. Bunking off school. The truancy rate in English schools has risen to a record high.
Also ahead on BBC News 24, back in business, Sir Mingus Campbell plans to convince supporters the Liberal Democrats are fit for government. And cleared for landing. We're live at Florida's Kennedy Space Center as the shuttle Atlantis prepares to touch down.
Hello, good morning. A man has been arrested in connection with the death of three sailors who drowned when their yacht disappeared in the English Channel last month. P&O Ferries has confirmed that one of its employees who worked on the Pride of Bilbao has been released on bail. The three men who died, James Meeby, Jason Downer and Rupert Saunders, were sailing from the Isle of Wight to Devon for the Dartmouth Regatta.
The possibility that the missing yacht collided with a much larger vessel, such as a cross-channel ferry, was one unconfirmed theory that investigators were reported to have been looking into since the boat's disappearance. The Uzo, a 26-foot yacht, hasn't been recovered after disappearing a month ago on its way from the Isle of Wight to a regatta in Devon. The bodies of 35-year-old Jason Downer and Rupert Saunders and James Meeby, both 36, were found a few days later drowned in the channel. Investigators had inspected some ferries during inquiries, but now a 61-year-old man from Dover in Kent's been arrested on suspicion of manslaughter through gross negligence after presenting himself at a Hampshire police station earlier today. He was released on bail. Andrew Burrows, BBC News.
The BBC's Top Gear presenter, Richard Hammond, has been seriously injured in a car crash while filming for the programme. He was driving a jet-powered car when the accident happened at an airfield near York. A safety official at the track says the car, similar to the vehicle shown here, was attempting to break the British land speed record. Mr. Hammond was airlifted to hospital in Leeds. He's in intensive care and is described as remaining in a serious but stable condition.
Richard Hammond doing what he loves best on Top Gear, driving as fast as he can. His easygoing charm and boyish enthusiasm has won him millions of fans around the world.
I'm going to do that again.
Yesterday he was driving a Vampire, a jet-propelled car like this one. It's capable of speeds over 300 miles an hour, and Richard had been driving one at Elvington Airfield near York. A spectator filmed this practice run, but on the next attempt he crashed.
As he came up the runway, he went through the finish gate as per normal and pulled the lever which operates the parachute and the fuel cutoff for the jet engine, which is normal procedure as it goes through the finish gate. And then it just veered off to the right onto the grass and rolled over several times.
He was taken by air ambulance to Leeds General Infirmary, critically injured. A spokesman said his condition improved slightly overnight and was still serious but stable. His wife Mindy has been at his bedside. The main Top Gear presenter, Jeremy Clarkson, has also been to see him. Another, James May, said he was devastated by the news. Richard Hammond has gained a wider audience on other programmes and has also written a children's book about science, which he spoke about on Breakfast a few months ago.
When I'm, you know, driving a car on Top Gear, and if I'm feeling acceleration through the seat, that's physics, that's what's happening. Or if I'm screeching around the track and I'm losing grip, that's because of physics.
Richard Hammond has gained a reputation on Top Gear for doing ever more daredevil stunts, something which colleagues say has become more of a requirement on modern television.
Once upon a time, the likes of Fife Roberts or Alan Wicker, or even the late Raymond Baxter, who died just this week, would have stood next to the action in a smart suit, painting a picture with words. But that's no longer enough.
Serious questions will now be asked about the safety precautions taken before yesterday's filming in Yorkshire and perhaps more widely about television presenters generally taking such risks. Richard Lister, BBC News.
Well, let's go live to the Leeds General Infirmary and speak to our correspondent there, Danny Savage. And Danny, has there been any further update from the hospital there?
Well, Matthew, within the last hour, Richard's co-presenter, Jeremy Clarkson, one of the probably the best known of the trio who present Top Gear, has arrived here at the Leeds General Infirmary. He declined to comment as he walked into the hospital here this morning, obviously here to see Richard and to be at his bedside and offer Richard's wife some support. The latest condition check that we had is that Richard's in a serious but stable condition here at the hospital, and his condition improved slightly overnight, because when I was here late yesterday evening he was described as being in a critical condition. He'd crashed that vehicle, that jet-powered dragster, about 30 miles from here at Elvington Airfield near York on a runway that's about 2 miles long, ideal for speed testing vehicles. He was airlifted here, unconscious when paramedics got to him. He did regain consciousness of sorts when he got here, but he is on one of the neurological wards here at the Leeds General Infirmary. Well, there is specialist care at this hospital in the centre of Leeds, but his condition is very serious. It was a very high-speed crash. He's got some serious injuries, and I think it will be some time before we know just what the long-term consequences of what happened yesterday are for him.
Danny, we're seeing pictures from the airfield of the wreckage itself. Just tell us a little about how the investigation or investigations will actually work.
OK, well, this accident happened last night, afternoon, about 5 or 6 o'clock. Police, of course, were on the scene pretty quickly, along with paramedics. My understanding is that the wreckage of the vehicle was scattered over quite a wide area on the runway at Elvington, and that was covered with a tarpaulin overnight. An investigation is going to begin now today. The health and safety executive are there today, we understand, to begin their investigation into what happened. The BBC, who make Top Gear, say that they're going to cooperate fully with this investigation. They're also holding their own inquiry into what went wrong. But you have to say that health and safety is a priority at these sorts of things. It would have been some very sort of stringent safety conditions in place. But what the experts are saying, as soon as you start testing any vehicle at speeds of more than 150 or 160 miles per hour, if something goes mechanically wrong and it crashes, the consequences could be fatal. It could be very, really serious consequences if it crashes at those speeds. So an investigation underway today. We're obviously not going to know about the results of that anytime soon, but there will be a thorough look into what happened yesterday evening just outside York at that airfield.
OK, for now, Danny Savage, thanks very much. And digital viewers can see more about Richard Hammond's accident by pressing the red button and then selecting News Multiscreen.
The Attorney General, Lord Goldsmith, has admitted that he's prepared to back the use of intercept evidence in court, making it now highly likely that the ban on phone tap evidence will eventually be lifted. Lord Goldsmith says he's determined to find a way round the obstacles which currently stop wiretap evidence going before a jury. Let's get to reaction to what Lord Goldsmith has been saying from Dominic Grieve. He's the Shadow Attorney General, of course, over at Westminster for us. Is this the way forward, do you think?
Oh, I'm sure it's the way forward. We've been pressing for this for several years and have been slightly disappointed that the government has been so slow in pursuing it. It's quite clear that if you want to convict serious criminals, and particularly terrorists, you're going to need to have phone tap evidence admitted. And the alternative, which is to resort to control orders or detention without trial, undermines confidence in our civil liberties and in the criminal in our justice system. So we need to get this evidence in. Now, I first acknowledge there are problems with it, and I'm sure the security services have had anxieties. But we think there are ways in which it can be done. You can have a judge who sifts the material and make sure that the material which is used is fair to the accused, and also make sure that the accused representatives don't get access to sensitive information about how the information was obtained, or indeed can ensure that unused material doesn't have to be disclosed, unless of course it's of real use to the defence. And with those things in place, I'm sure that this system can be operated properly.
There must be a reason, though, that the security services have always had anxieties about this, and no one surely wants to compromise their ability to do their work, which is by definition covert.
Yes, I'm sure they have anxieties about it, and I'm sure life is much easier for them simply being able to go and get an interception warrant from the Home Secretary, carry out interception, and not have to discuss it or use it for any other purpose other than build up an intelligence picture. But allow people to go unconvicted when there is clear evidence in the intercept material that they're committing crime is a real problem, and I think we need to have these people convicted. And it is worth bearing in mind that many other countries, including the United States, succeed both in maintaining good intelligence services and convicting people on phone tap evidence.
It's fair to say that we shouldn't think that introducing phone tap evidence into a case, though, is a panacea, because we can't all sit here and assume that A talks to B and says, yes, it'll be next Wednesday at Marble Arch. I mean, it simply doesn't work like that, does it?
I entirely agree about that. And, of course, there are other sources of intelligence which will not be capable of being revealed in court and which can't be used. But my understanding is that there is quite a lot of phone tap material around which could be useful in convicting serious criminals and terrorists. And I think the time has come for that to be used in court.
All right. Dominic Grieve, Shadow Attorney General. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Now, before we move on, let me just take you to NASA Mission Control, because there they chart the course of Atlantis as it makes its re-entry within the next 10 minutes. It is due to touch down at 11:21. Let's just little in.
Okay, we'll take TPS for now.
In addition, for the first time, global positioning satellite data will be accepted by one of the computers on board the shuttle. Velocity now 4,300 miles an hour, Mach 6. Altitude 25 statute miles. 225 miles to the landing site. All systems looking good. Three good auxiliary power units.
Well, there you see, on course to be landing at 11:21. 21 exactly, 225 miles away from the Kennedy Space Center, going at an extraordinary 4,300 miles an hour. Before it actually slowed down its orbit speed, fascinating, 18,000 miles per hour. But we will return there to the Kennedy Space Center and see those live pictures of Atlantis landing within the next few minutes. Do stay with us for all of that. We'll take you right through that landing process.
Atlantis continues.
Well, before that, the number of pupils playing truant from primary schools in England has increased in the last year. On some days, at least 50,000 school children are playing truant without permission. But truancy levels in secondary schools has seen a slight decrease. Let's speak to our education correspondent, Sue Littlemore, who's here with me in the studio. And whichever way you look at it, in terms of the figures itself, these are record levels, aren't they?
Yes, and it's bad news for the government, which from its very beginning, this Labour government linked reducing truancy to tackling social exclusion. So what we see today is a slight increase in the numbers of pupils playing truant in all our schools. There's been a slight decrease in secondary school pupils playing truant, but an increase in primary schools. So more primary school pupils and more days lost in primary schools to truancy. So really, in a school year, in the last school year, we saw 17% of primary school pupils play truant at some point during that year.
It's a recognition, isn't it, of the continued failure of government policy, because at so many different levels through the course of this Labour government, they have tried to tackle this and they are clearly still failing.
They made it a political priority, as I said, from the beginning. David Blunkett made big announcements on cracking down on parents, sending them to prison, increasing their fines if they didn't get their children into school. Charles Clark had another go with another raft of proposals, parenting contracts, fixed penalty notices, sort of parking fines if you didn't get your children into school. They've made a big issue of this, so this will be very disappointing news. Already, the schools minister this morning, Jim White, has said we must keep up the pressure to reduce truancy.
And what does he mean, apart from a bland statement like that, in terms of the actual practicalities? What are the government saying they will do to address this now?
What they have been doing over the last year is targeting schools which have got the most persistent truants. Quite a small number of truants can cause an awful lot of truancy, persistent hardcore truants. They've been running a project where they have combined some pressure and support, threat of prosecuting parents, sending them to court, but in the meantime giving them help over things like drug use, mental health problems, parenting skills if they feel there are families that need that. They claim this has been a successful project. The overall figures, though, it hasn't fed through to the overall national picture yet.
Okay, Sue Littlemore, thanks very much for that. Thanks a lot.
Let me just tell you something to flag up that we expect to hear at midday, to do with airline baggage restrictions. There's been a talk in the media in the last few days that there will be an easing of what you can take on board, essentially slightly different requirements as to how much you're allowed to take on board a flight. We are expecting a government statement on that at midday. So we will have the final details as to where we stand now in terms of what you can take on board a flight. And we think the restrictions will be eased. Full details at midday.
Time though, 11:15, our main headlines here this morning. And a man has been arrested in connection with the deaths of three sailors who drowned when their yacht disappeared in the English Channel last month. The P&O Ferries employee who worked on the Pride of Bilbao has been released on bail.
The Top Gear programme presenter Richard Hammond remains seriously ill in hospital this morning after last night's high-speed crash. He was driving a jet-powered dragster which is thought to have overturned during filming at an airfield.
The Attorney General, Lord Goldsmith, has admitted he's prepared to back the use of intercept evidence in court, making it highly likely that the ban on phone tap evidence will be lifted.
In sport, it's decision day for the two captains at the Ryder Cup. Ian Woosnam will announce Europe's opening pairings as they look to retain the trophy. America's captain, Tom Lehman, will follow suit with the names due to be revealed this afternoon. Bad weather in County Kildare is continuing to cause concern. It's thought the opening ceremony at the K Club this afternoon could be at risk from high winds. And Greg Wozetsky will kick off Britain's Davis Cup tie against Ukraine tomorrow. Britain need to win to avoid being relegated to the third tier of team tennis. Those are the sports headlines. More later. See you then.
Tonya, thanks very much.
Just a little more information coming through about Richard Hammond, still in intensive care, of course, in hospital, as we've been saying. Jeremy Clarkson, the other main presenter perhaps of Top Gear, has just issued a statement from Leeds General Infirmary, and he says, James May and I, the third member of the team, of course, James May and I are at the hospital in Leeds where Richard remains in intensive care. Obviously, at this time, both he and his family are the most important concerns we have. It must be devastating for his wife, Mindy, and his two utterly adorable children.
So those are the latest thoughts from Jeremy Clarkson, just issuing that statement about his friend and colleague there in the hospital. We will keep an eye on that story and bring you any more as we get it.
Now, 17 minutes past, so let's turn our attentions to the space shuttle, because it's only a few minutes away. That's the plan anyway. Atlantis due to land in Florida. A few hiccups, we'll discuss those in just a moment, but broadly we have had very positive signs coming out of NASA. Excellent weather conditions as well, we're told. And we will be awaiting the landing of Atlantis. Always an exciting moment. We'll be following that. Dr. Robert Massey is with us, as ever, on these occasions from the Royal Observatory in Greenwich. Hello again. Good morning to you. How's it looking? What are people telling you?
Well, it's looking very positive. I mean, when you get this close to a landing, it should be absolutely fine. I think if anything was going wrong at this point, we'd be hearing about it right now.
I sense I made you a little bit nervous there, actually, when I talked about it. I wasn't trying to put a damper on things.
No.
I was reflecting on, you know, the little bits of debris that they talked about and so on, because inevitably, given past events, they have to be very, very cautious.
Oh, absolutely. And, I mean, I suppose when you think about this, there is actually... Oh, we're seeing some footage of it coming in now, which is a good sign.
Atlantis, Houston, on at the 180.
Copy, on at the 180.
Pilot Chris Ferguson now flying. A call that the course is...
Robert, when you get to this moment and they are back in communication, perhaps the riskiest part of this whole process has been completed, because they go into a silence, don't they, for many minutes during re-entry, where, of course, Columbia was lost. But by this stage, we perhaps are beyond the most risky phase, aren't we?
Absolutely. I mean, the shuttle's gone through the moment when it reaches the highest temperature as it comes into the Earth's atmosphere. And it comes in at very high speed, thousands of miles an hour, uses the Earth's atmosphere to slow down. And that's the most dangerous bit, because that's when the temperature's at their highest. Once it's gone through that, it's travelling at speeds which are more comparable to that of an airliner as it comes into land. Somewhat faster, but you know, we're not talking thousands of miles an hour, we're talking hundreds.
And we should talk a wee bit about the mission as well, and those fabulous images of the spacewalks. We watch them all over the course of the mission. It's just fascinating, no matter how many times you watch it, even for people like us who don't fully understand what's happening in the way that you do. But, I mean, is it deemed, within the industry, if you like, is it deemed to have been a successful mission?
I think very much so. I mean, it really was essential for the American Space Agency, for NASA, to get this right, because if they want to complete the construction of the space station, this is the...
Altitude 100,000 feet, or just about 2 miles, 6.5 miles to touchdown. Speed 400 miles an hour.
And Robert, am I right in saying that these are the pictures from the cockpit? This is how the astronauts are currently viewing their descent and their approach.
Absolutely. I mean, you have to bear in mind there's a time difference. It's still dark there, but absolutely, it's all early morning.
Well, I'm going to confess, I'm not sure what I'm looking at there, but I'm sure you could explain it.
I think these are the cockpit images, aren't they?
I think your eyesight may be better than mine.
I think you're seeing the runway there in front of it.
And just, Robert, just whilst we stay with these pictures, did they manually land this, or is this all done via computers? The actual landing part, this that we're watching now.
There's a choice. You know, the pilot can take control, or they can do it on autopilot. It's up to them.
Gear down locked. Touchdown. Drag chute deploy. Nose gear touchdown.
Well, there it is. Atlantis. Home. Safe. Well. The end of their 12-day mission. And Robert, I interrupted you a little earlier. You were talking about the the whole importance of this mission itself?
Well, I mean, it's the first mission to continue the assembly of the International Space Station since the Columbia accidents. That's well over 3 years since any work's happened on it, and it really was absolutely essential that this one was successful for that reason. Otherwise, it would probably have been impossible to complete the construction of the space station, which is really now what the shuttle's being used for.
We copy, we'll stop. Welcome back. Congratulations on return to assembly. We have no immediate post-landing deltas. We'll meet you on page 5-3 for post-landing.
I won't get you to explain NASA speak like that, but Jane was talking about the three spacewalks that we saw, and they were just astonishing pictures like they always are. I mean, it was quite an arduous trip for these astronauts, wasn't it? Because they're long, long spacewalks.
Well, even in training, you know, and they sometimes they train underwater, they use different environments to try these things out, and even rehearsing them, it's still a difficult thing. I mean, I suppose you've got the combination of the slight sense of disorientation you've got up there, coupled with trying to maneuver things which, although effectively they feel as though they have no weight, I mean, they're still in the influence of the Earth's gravitational field, but they feel weightless. You've still got to maneuver them around the, you know, the big things. Assembling things in that environment is a tough call.
The assembly of the International Space Station,
it's a little
delivery
work.
And installation of a brand new truss structure and solar
array.
Just
stay with some of the audio of this because it is eternally fascinating.
Atlantis's landing convoy will now begin maneuvering into place. Almost 80 personnel on hand at Kennedy Space Center to help safe the vehicle. Again, this was the space shuttle's 15th night landing at Kennedy Space Center, 21st night landing in all, the 63rd landing at Kennedy, concluding the space shuttle program's 116th mission.
There it is, Atlantis on the runway. It has no power itself, does it? So it eventually gets towed around, and that takes some while. But just more generally, you were talking about how important this was to actually get work underway again with the space station. There are plans for, what, another 15 shuttle flights before 2010. Do you think that's realistic, given even in the last two we've seen all of the worries about the tiles and the heat shields? Do you think we are going to get another 15 flights?
My hunch is yes. I mean, there does seem to be a real determination to make this happen,
and Brent,
I suppose,
we have you loud,
given
the
time that's been invested in the space station, that, you know, it's something that has to be completed. I think it's very, very sensible to retire the fleet in 2010, though, and look to a new orbit, look to a new system, a new vehicle to take people in space.
We show ourselves complete through the bottom of 5-3.
And Houston copies the complete through the bottom of page 5-3.
And I'm always curious, how long does it take, if you know the answer to this, how long does it take to readjust, if you like, as an individual after everything that your body has been through in that 12, 13-day mission?
Well, I suppose it varies with your physiology, but certainly it's going to be a day or two. I mean, there are, of course, people who sit on the space station or float around the space station for hundreds of days, and the Russians, the duration record is more than a year, and then I'm sure, you know, it would take you more than a few days to recover. But it isn't. You also have changes to your physiology for very long periods in space that, in some cases, you never quite recover from. But a short mission like this, I'm sure everybody's fine.
I think the current crew on the International Space Station have been there since March, I think. Yeah, so it's a few months, yeah.
So in a sense, the arguments about long space flights through the solar system, it's not about the time in space so much as just the, you know, the lack of resources, the way we'd actually service flights if we decided to go off to Mars. But we do have a lot of experience of people spending a long time in space. And returning to Earth, I wouldn't say without any ill effects, but it can be done.
And in terms of where we are with the station itself and how far down the line it is in terms of completion, they were building these solar panels, which once they're hooked up, they're not hooked up yet, it sort of doubles the power there at the space station. What is left to do after all of that?
Well, quite a bit. There's still quite a few modules need to be added. I think there's something like 14 trusses they have to put in. This is something like the fourth. You know, it basically is a very, very big structure, and perhaps part of the problem with the original concept was that it did depend so heavily on the space shuttle. You know, the Russian Soyuz vehicles are very good at taking crew up and down, including the first woman space tourist only last week. But,
yes.
You know, for all that, it's a very, very elaborate project. And, you know, I'm not sure we'd do it again if we were starting from here.
And once completed, how long does it last? What do they do up there?
Well, that's an interesting question. You know, and to be honest with you, I'm not sure there are clear answers. I mean, the scientific community is certainly divided on the merits of the space station and its utility to astronomy. I mean, and my experience of talking to people at conferences about this is that basically they say, well, the space station's there, so we will use it as a platform for research. It isn't necessarily what they'd start with, but, you know, there are plans to put different X-ray telescopes and various other things we can use to study the wider universe on board, try out industrial applications in zero gravity and so on.
Fascinating.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much for being with us, as ever. I'm sure you'll be here for the next one. That's what we hope. Thanks very much, Dr. Robert Massey from the Royal Observatory. Thank you for now, anyway. Thanks.
And plenty more from NASA through the course of our programme. Usually the course of action is that they have a news conference a little later once those astronauts have returned there to base. So we'll keep an eye on that. Once there is more, we'll obviously bring it to you. Now, though, other news, and police have arrested a third person in connection with the Cash for Honours inquiry. Sir Christopher Evans was taken to a police station outside London for questioning last night by officers from the Metropolitan Police's Specialist Crime Directorate. He was then bailed to return pending further inquiries. Well, let's speak now to our political correspondent, Vicky Young, who's in Westminster for us. And, Vicky, just tell us a little more, first of all, about the nature of the arrest itself.
That's right. This is the first actual donor to be arrested. There was speculation that the inquiry was flagging a little bit, but that doesn't seem to be the case now. The person arrested, as you say, is Sir Christopher Evans. Now, he's the founder of a company called Merlin Biosciences, which is involved in lots of different projects, a venture capital company trying to raise money, and very much involved in stem cell research. Now, he donated £1 million to Labour last year in the run-up to the general election. We understand that he was questioned, and then he's been released on bail.
And what happens now? Because one remembers at the start of this inquiry, it was dismissed by some, but it has been going on for such a long time. How much is left, do you think?
I think that's the big question. The speculation, of course, here is about how long it's going to take and whether the Prime Minister himself will be questioned. There had been some speculation that would happen before Labour's party conference, which starts this weekend in Manchester. That now looks a little bit unlikely. It looks like the timetable is slipping. The next significant stage would be a file being taken by the police to the Crown Prosecution Service to see if there will be a continuation of this investigation and any kind of prosecutions. We now understand that isn't going to be by the end of this month. It's more likely to be later on in October, possibly even November. But certainly what's interesting here is that Sir Christopher Evans hasn't had a peerage. That shows that they're going beyond their remit. They're not just talking about loans for peerages here.
OK. Vicky Young, thanks very much.
Just a comment in from the Home Office on another story we were talking about just a little while ago. Intercept evidence, essentially phone tap evidence, largely with the Attorney General, Lord Goldsmith, saying that he felt that it should be allowed to be used in court cases. The Home Office saying we are continuing to look very closely at intercept evidence. There is a clear government commitment to this work, but also recognition of the need to protect our intercept capability.
Yes, it then goes on the statement to talk about the current situation, the current acts where there is a statutory ban on the use of intercept evidence. It then refers to the comprehensive review of intercept evidence conducted in 2003 and 2004. But it concludes the statement by saying there is ongoing work to review these issues and identify, if possible, a legal model which would provide the necessary safeguards to allow intercept material to be used as evidence. So those, the latest thoughts coming to us from the Home Office. We'll bring you more on that as we get it.
Much more coming up after half past. Right now, though, we'll find out what's happening with the weather. Here's Jay Wynn. Jay.
Thanks very much, Jane. It's a beautiful day for much of the UK today. It's certainly very warm, and we've got a southerly breeze to thank for that. Southerly breeze and some sunshine raising those temperatures. 19 degrees in Aberdeen, not too bad at all. But you notice some wetter weather for northern and western areas. That rain's slowly clearing away from Glasgow. Brighter skies developing here. Look at those temperatures. Newcastle, Manchester, 24 degrees through the early afternoon. 25 degrees in London and rising further. It's those southerly winds bringing in that warm air and the sunshine. Maybe some slightly choppy seas along the south coast, but inland it's warm and it's sunny, if a little bit on the breezy side. 23 degrees in Cardiff, very nice indeed. As we head across the Irish Sea, we're back into that cloud and still some rain to come through the early afternoon across Northern Ireland. Most of that rain slowly eases away towards the far northwest through the afternoon. Most of us fine and sunny, 28 possibly your top temperature. Overnight tonight through the Irish Sea, see some very windy weather, severe gales certainly possible. Most of that's out of the way. Friday sees some sunshine, but also some showers.
Within the last few minutes, who decides what makes the news? Do they tackle the things you think are important? Do they really show you the full picture? If you want to have your say about what we see and hear, Newswatch lets you talk to the people who set the news agenda right across the BBC. Newswatch, tomorrow at 8:45 on BBC News 24, or log on to bbc.co.uk/newswatch.
Questions, I've got some questions I want to know. But what if I could ask you only one thing, only this one time? What would you tell me?
The Politics Show, looking for answers, Sunday at midday.
Hello, good morning. This is BBC News 24 with Matthew Amrolywala and Jane Hill.
Now, a man has been arrested in connection with the deaths of three sailors. The men drowned when their yacht disappeared in the English Channel last month. P&O Ferries have confirmed that one of their employees, who worked on the Pride of Bilbao, has been released on bail.
The television presenter Richard Hammond remains in a serious but stable condition in hospital this morning. The 36-year-old was injured while, while filming for the BBC's Top Gear programme. He was driving a jet-powered car when it left the track and flipped over.
The number of pupils playing truant from primary schools in England has increased in the last year. On some days, at least 50,000 schoolchildren are playing truant. But truancy levels in secondary schools have seen a slight decrease.
The Attorney General, Lord Goldsmith, has admitted that he's prepared to back the use of intercept evidence in court, making it likely that the ban on phone tap evidence will be lifted. He says he's determined to find a way round the obstacles which currently stop wiretap evidence going before a jury.
The Liberal Democrat leader, Sir Min Campbell, will wind up his party's conference with a keynote address shortly. He's expected to say the party is back in business after the past year's turmoil.
The Education Secretary Alan Johnson's special advisers have been told they must not get involved in decisions about when to release school test results. The criticism comes after officials were accused of burying bad news by publishing poor primary school results on the same day as the more positive GCSE figures.
Well, that's our summary. You want more on any of those stories, you can get it using our interactive service, BBC i. Those just some of the selections available to you. Just press the red button and make your way there.
It's been confirmed this morning that a patient at Stoke-on-Trent's main hospital has been implanted with a body part which was allegedly stolen by gangs in the United States. The hospital says it was a customer of the American company Biomedical Tissue Services, which allegedly exported body parts which were taken without the permission of relatives. Well, the University Hospital of North Staffordshire has issued a statement about this. Its spokesman, Kevin Smith, gave journalists that statement just a little earlier.
Following further clarification from the company and a further check, we've now established that we did receive items from the affected batch numbers. Our records show that one item has been implanted in a patient. We're in the process of contacting the patient to give them full details and to reassure them there is a negligible clinical risk. While this incident has not put patients at risk, we're investigating to establish why this was not correctly identified during the first search.
So that was the statement from the hospital. Let's get more from our correspondent, Liz Copper. And it's a slightly convoluted tale, this, isn't it, Liz? I guess we have to explain to people how we've reached this point.
That's right. The statement from the hospital that we've had this morning does confirm that they are trying to contact a patient. We don't have any details about that patient. We understand the patient received a bone graft operation, but we don't know when that happened at the hospital. I think what's slightly embarrassing for the hospital in this particular case is that it was a approached by the BBC earlier this week to confirm whether or not any of its patients had been affected by the effective batches of this material. When they spoke to us earlier this week, they categorically said no, they hadn't been any patients who had been affected. They've subsequently had to go back, recheck their records. In that rechecking process, they've discovered a mistake was made, and that's why this morning they've had to issue that statement. And as we heard one of the clinical directors say there in the statement, that whilst they say that no patients have been put at risk, they are investigating to establish why this was not correctly identified during that first surge.
Yes, in terms of the British side of this story, I guess for them that's the crucial point, the point that they are adamant that no one is at risk here. It's a fairly unpleasant tale, but no one's health is at risk.
They are certainly very keen to stress to us that there is a what they call a negligible clinical risk. That said, the individual hospitals who have been contacted, North Staffordshire is one of them, it has been left to them to decide whether they contact patients. In this case, they have certainly felt it's important enough to track down this patient, although, as I say, we're not even sure whether they have spoken to the patient yet.
Indeed. Well, clearly a little more to emerge there. Liz Copper for now. Thank you very much.
Now to a few stories in brief. And UK and Italian forces in southern Iraq have formally handed over security control in the province of Dikar to Iraqi forces. It's the second of 18 provinces to be handed over after a similar move in the neighbouring Muthana in July. This second province is in the country's less troubled area, has been in the British area of control since 2003.
A court in Jordan has sentenced a failed female suicide bomber to death for trying to take part in attacks which killed 60 people in the capital, Amman, last year. Sajida al-Rishawi made a televised confession a few days after the triple hotel bombing, but pleaded not guilty in court. Six other people were sentenced in absentia and remain at large.
The US state of California is taking legal action against some of the world's biggest motor manufacturers for polluting the environment. It's the first lawsuit of its kind, and the state alleges that greenhouse gases from vehicle emissions are causing global warming.
The humanitarian crisis in the Darfur region of Sudan will be the subject of a major international conference tomorrow. The UN Security Council plus 10 other nations will meet in New York to consider the options. The Sudanese authorities have agreed to allow African Union peacekeepers to remain in the region for the time being.
A report by the wildlife charity WWF has found traces of chemicals in a list of basic foods like bread, butter and olive oil. The organisation says the combination of chemicals, when added together, could be potentially harmful to humans. It warns they're implicated in hormonal changes, cancers and immune deficiencies.
14 everyday foods have been tested for chemicals that get into products from the environment or packaging. Low levels of pesticides were found, flame retardants, non-stick chemicals, artificial musks used to scent products, and higher levels of phthalates, which are used in plastics.
We found every food was contaminated. They might be suspected carcinogens, they might be suspected of human neurological impairment in development, or disrupting male reproductive health.
At this laboratory in the London School of Pharmacy, experiments are being carried out into how a range of chemicals work together in cells. This will help us greater understand how a cocktail of chemicals affects humans.
Many chemicals, even when they're present at doses without effects, may work together to act in concert in a mixture to produce something significant.
The Food Standards Agency says the low levels of chemicals found are not individually harmful, but they are now looking at how they add up in our diet. Thousands of chemicals on the market prior to 1981 have not been tested for their effect on human health. European legislation, being debated and voted on later this year, will attempt to gradually remove hazardous substances.
We feel these levels in isolation are not harmful. Having said that, what we are looking to do is to identify where substances might react with other substances to produce an additional concern that we perhaps have not yet fully appreciated and analysed.
But some scientists insist the benefits of these chemicals outweigh the risks. For example, non-stick chemicals prevent burnt food, which contain potential carcinogens. Nicola Stanbridge, BBC News.
Now, let me bring you breaking news regarding the coup in Thailand, because within the last few minutes, the ousted Thai Prime Minister, Thaksin Shinawatra, who of course is in this country at the moment, has called for a new general election to be held in his homeland quickly, but said he himself would be taking a, quote, deserved rest from politics. That is a statement he has just issued within the last few minutes.
He remains in London, of course, in theory on a private visit. I think he has family here, for example. Meanwhile, in Bangkok, things remain relatively peaceful. A bloodless coup, of course, and calls there for a swift imposition of a new government. But we'll keep you up to date with that. But that's the first statement that Thaksin Shinawatra has released, certainly since he's been here in Britain.
Now here, the court-martial of seven soldiers charged in connection with the alleged inhumane treatment of prisoners in Iraq is continuing in Wiltshire. Today the court is hearing from the prosecution about alleged negligence by three men, including a colonel, the most senior officer to face charges. Well, let's cross live to Philippa Thomas outside that military court near Salisbury for the very latest. And we've heard about Corporal Payne's earlier statements today, haven't we, Philippa?
We have. Corporal Donald Payne, Matthew, is the soldier who's accused of manslaughter of Bahar Musa, one of the Iraqi civilians who was detained. Now, Corporal Payne is denying the manslaughter charge, although he has admitted inhuman treatment. We heard quite a lot of what he said in his first interviews back in 2003 and 2004. And at the time, he said he never saw anyone use physical force. There were no kicks and no punches. He never saw anyone humiliated. He said they were all treated correctly. Now, you'll remember in the opening evidence, we heard that Bahar Musa had at least 93 injuries to his body. For the prosecution, Julian Bevan QC said then, it's plain that since the corporal has pleaded guilty to inhuman treatment, much of what he said in those interviews is untrue. And he told the panel, you deserve to hear what he said in those interviews.
And what possibly could have been the motivation for the soldiers?
Quite a lot was said about that by Julian Bevan QC. He said, you have to understand that soldiers serving in Basra at the time were facing the daily risk of death at the hands of Iraqi insurgents. They had recently lost a much-loved officer, and there had been the recent and highly publicized death of a group of Royal Military Police officers. And they felt that the group of detainees they had under their control could have been linked to those deaths. And add to that, Matthew, the fact that weapons had been found at the hotel at the time of the arrest, including pistols, AK-47s, grenades and a sniper sight as well.
OK, Philippa Thomas, more from you a little later. For now, thanks very much.
Time just coming up to a quarter to 12. These are the latest news headlines. A man has been arrested in connection with the death of three sailors who drowned when their yacht disappeared in the English Channel last month. An employee of P&O Ferries who worked on the Pride of Bilbao has been released on bail.
The Top Gear programme presenter, Richard Hammond, is seriously ill in hospital after a high-speed car crash. He was driving a jet-powered dragster, which is thought to have overturned during filming at an airfield.
And the Attorney General, Lord Goldsmith, has admitted he's prepared to back the use of intercept evidence in court, making it highly likely that the ban on phone tap evidence will be lifted. Now, we are about quarter of an hour away, of course, from a very important moment for Sir Ming Campbell. He'll be walking onto the podium at midday. We're reliably informed it's his first speech as party leader at conference, of course. And our chief political correspondent, James Landale, is there. And a healthy crowd behind you, James, as you would expect for his speech.
Yeah, I have to say, the Lib Dems have, we've seen pretty more of them, I think, this much this week. Certainly it was a full house for the big tax vote earlier on this week. It's also a full house, obviously, now for the leader's speech, traditional moment, and a big moment for Mingus Campbell as his first outing as party leader. Here to discuss it, Michael White of The Guardian. Michael, how important is it that he delivers it in the right way and not just the actual words themselves?
I think it's very important. You and I are in the position, which the viewers aren't, of having seen the text. And it's, you know, okay speech, solidly make, a lot of people put in a lot of work, covering no unexpected points, but it's how he does it. And he's got to look like a, you know, a mature, experienced, jolly, we hope, old gentleman, like myself, but even jollier, rather than a sort of tired old bloke. And that's important when people watch it on television, on the news tonight. So delivery and style and confidence is what's going to save this speech or make it a failure.
The way the speech has been spun to the likes of you and me is that there's a link here between Ming Campbell, the man, and the strategy of the party, and the word is substance. He's a man, they say, of substance. This is a party of substance. This is a party that has a tax policy in the way the other parties keep quiet about it. Do you buy that sort of structure?
Well, before we came into the studio here, I was having a furious row with a Lib Dem MP, all good fun and affectionate, about the dangers of having a tax policy which is very detailed at this stage. We heard it from Vince Cable, the economic spokesman, earlier this week, who's a seriously clever bloke. Even Gordon Brown respects him. There aren't many people you can say that about, Labour or Liberal Dem. So they've got these policies and they've got these detailed figures which were in the papers this week, but the Tories and Labour no doubt are already hacking away at them, finding holes in them, contradictions. That's risky. On the other hand, as Ming Campbell will say, it's serious, it's substance. They're not like David Cameron, who is still at the policy formation stage. They've got a document, and that's impressive, but it's also risky.
The classic question, Liberal Democrats, are they going for the Labour vote, are they going for the Tory vote? From the base of the text you've seen and what we've heard all this week, which way are they heading?
Well, what they're saying is that if you have a tax package and there'll be a spending package, reducing spending, coming later, Ming accepts that there's no money in, you know, loony lefting on spending nowadays, that if they, and times are getting tighter too under any party, if you have a tax package which cuts taxes for most people, that's their promise, 80 or 90% of people will get substantial cuts, then that surely benefits Conservative and Labour and Lib Dem voters. But on foreign policy and on public services, health service, schools and things, you get an echo of the old Lib Dem party, Charles Kennedy, if you like. He's not going to get a mention in this speech today, tit for tat there, that you get the sort of old view which is, you know, you've got to have a lot of spending and a lot of high services, easier said than done, but it ties in with the fact that Ming grew up, although he looks rather posh, grew up in fairly modest circumstances. His father couldn't go to university, he wanted to be a doctor, and we'll get a bit more of that. And I went to state school, I went to university on the state, I became an international Olympic athlete with state support. That's what he'll be saying, that sort of thing. So he's trying to pin in the vote on the left.
Okay. Michael White, thank you very much indeed. Ming Campbell on his feet shortly, preceded by a little, as Michael said, a little slideshow telling us a little bit about Ming the man. Certainly, they're trying to sell him here.
We look forward to it. James, thank you very much. We will be back there in Brighton at midday for that.
Quickly back to the Kennedy Space Centre. And there it is, Atlantis safely on the ground. And there you see the air bridge just being manoeuvred close to the shuttle. So within the next few minutes, those six astronauts who spent 12 days in space on this very important 12-day mission will actually emerge. So we'll keep an eye on those pictures, and when those astronauts emerge, hopefully, if Ming Campbell is not speaking, we will bring those pictures and any comments to you. But that's seen there live in Florida.
Right now, let's catch up with business. Hello, Mariam. What do you have for us today?
We're talking about online websites and their accessibility for disabled and elderly people. Millions of people are struggling to shop online because websites are too difficult to use. The web design firm Nomensa says all of the top 30 shopping sites in Britain failed their tests for accessibility. Small text, pop-up adverts and difficult navigation, all these things cause problems for the elderly or people with disabilities. Campaigners say the retailers are missing out on a huge potential customer base with 10 million disabled people registered in Britain alone. Well, Simon Norris is managing director of Nomensa, a firm that designs websites. He's in central London for us. Simon, what are the main issues here? What are the main problems that people are facing when they want to access online sites to buy things?
I think there are a number of main issues. I think the thing that stands out for us most of all is that this Christmas, many people are going to use websites, or to put it another way, they're not going to be able to use websites to buy presents for their loved ones, and that obviously is a serious issue.
I mean, you'd think that online retailers would make it easier, especially for perhaps disabled or elderly people who perhaps could not get out as much as able-bodied people can or younger people can to buy, for example, Christmas presents.
Yes, our research revealed that of the 30 top UK shopping sites, 29 of them were extremely difficult, as you stated, for people with disabilities. They'd also be very difficult as well for people that wear glasses. This is obviously something that needs to be addressed.
What do you think needs to be done? What do you think these online retailers need to do? Change the look of their websites, make the font bigger?
I think what they need to do is as a first step, is find out exactly how well their websites currently support people. And that's all people, people with disabilities are an important group. But it's important to make sure they know where they stand and how well their websites actually perform right now. Once they've done that, what they can then do is start to make plans and preparations for actually making the changes to make sure that they can support as many people using their websites as possible.
OK, Simon, thank you very much indeed for joining us on News 24. So you'd think online retailers would actually want to make money. It's so much money in that kind of market, in the disabled and elderly market, people who can't access shops.
And everyone hates pop-up windows, let's face it.
This is very true.
That applies across the board. Just abolish them. Who needs them? Just click and that's it. Thanks, Marion. We'll see you a little bit later. Right now, we will catch up with all the latest sports news. Sonia McLaughlin is with us. Hi, Sonia.
Hello, Jane. Thank you very much. European team have begun their final practice round before the serious business of defending the Ryder Cup gets underway tomorrow. It's the chance for some fine-tuning before both captains announce their opening pairings later. But the weather continues to cause concern. Our reporter, Jo Wilson, is at the K Club in County Kildare, braced up, dressed up warm. Not unusual to have poor weather in Ireland, Joe, but what's the outlook at the moment?
Well, the reason I've still got a coat on at the moment is because, according to my weather forecast, right now we should be having strong winds and heavy rain. You'll be able to tell, hopefully, that it's not like that. In fact, we're seeing the sunshine. But I guess that really sums up the problem. It's completely unpredictable. I heard this morning that it's not the tail end of a hurricane we've got over this part of Ireland at the moment. It's actually a tropical storm. Not sure exactly what difference that makes. In the short term for this afternoon, we're still not sure whether this grand opening ceremony will be held outdoors as planned or whether they'll have to move it somewhere indoors. The problem, I suppose, is that we don't want to see leprechauns blown up into the air in 40 mile an hour winds, although I don't know, perhaps we do.
Both captains, Joe, will name their opening pairings today. How important is it that they get it right?
Yeah, really important, I think. And we heard, interestingly, from players like Padraig Harrington yesterday saying, look, you can't overanalyse these pairings. They are absolutely crucial. I suppose it's a question of either team getting the momentum. And, you know, normally, traditionally, it's the first 2 days, the team play days before the singles on Sunday, where Europe have excelled and they've been able to build up a bit of momentum. Now, looking at the pairings they're out on the course at the moment for Europe, Clark and Westwood playing together, Montgomery and Harrington playing together, big players in big partnerships. The balance always is for the captains. Do they do that? Do they put the big names together for a really strong team, or do they try and put in an experienced player with a reliable player and try and muddle along that way? Interesting problem in particular, that one for the American team, because remember, they have four rookies in their squad and they can't simply hide all of them on the Thursday and the Friday. You've got players, for instance, like Vaughan Taylor, who's not only not played in a Ryder Cup before, he's not really had any experience in this type of golf.
We're doing great. I don't think any of us made any rookie mistakes. I've had a lot of good advice from the veterans, just about keeping our cool and just way to handle things and carry ourselves. And I think, you know, us four rookies, we all know each other.